Hi, everyone. Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 15.3 to the public. This is available to all iOS 15 supported devices, from the iPhone 6S, 6S Plus, all the way up to the iPhone 13 Pro Max. And it's available at the same time everywhere around the world. And if you want to install the update and you're not seeing it yet, go to Settings, go to General, then Software Update, and you should see the update. If you're still not seeing it, turn off automatic updates, go back and check for an update, and you should see it. However, if you're a developer or public beta tester, you won't see the update until you delete the public beta profile or the beta profile in general, which can be found under VPN and device management. Once you delete that profile, if you're a developer or beta tester, reboot, go back to your settings and check for an update. You should see the update there, as it's a different build than what we had with iOS 15.3 RC. And so as far as this particular update, this was a very large install if you were a developer, coming in at 5.19 gigabytes on my iPhone 13 Pro Max, but it was anywhere between 1 to 5 gigabytes depending on your device. So on my 13 Pro Max, it was 5.19, and it was between 1 and 5 gigabytes on all the devices you see here, the iPhone 11, iPhone 10, iPhone 6S Plus. Along with this, Apple also released iPadOS 15.3 that I have on my 12.9 inch iPad Pro from 2021, along with WatchOS 8.4, tvOS 15.3, HomePodOS 15.3, and macOS 12.2. All of those are available now at the same time all around the world. Now let's take a look at the build number and talk about what's new. So we'll go to Settings, then we'll go to General, then About, and you can see the build number is 19D50. And this particular build includes bug fixes and security updates, but there's some small updates as well. However, the first thing is, if you're on the public version of iOS 15.2.1 and updating to 15.3, you'll have a modem update. However, if you are on 15.3 release candidate and updating to this, you shouldn't see a modem update. Modem updates typically fix issues with connectivity, switching between 5G and 5G UC and LTE and 4G. And then when you go back and forth between Wi-Fi, they'll re-enable and it should work a little bit better this time around. I've had no issues since this update with connectivity. As far as changes and updates in this update, well, Apple did say there's bug fixes and we'll talk about that in a moment. But the first physical update you can see has to do with podcasts. If you're within podcasts, and you go to your library and go to latest episodes, make sure your latest episodes are played. And if you have them filtered, it says marked as played, you'll see it says all caught up. Before it said all caught up, it actually said something a little different where it said no latest episodes. So they've changed some wording there. And you'll see a lot of this throughout iOS 15.3. The next thing is Apple Digital ID. Within the code of iOS 15.3 is the code necessary to make Digital ID work. However, they have not yet activated that yet. Later in February, Apple is said to be working with the TSA in the United States with a few selected states and a few select airports to allow you to use your iPhone as your digital ID. So we're waiting for that to be enabled. Eventually it will be in Wallet, and they could push that just like they pushed some update today to the Apple Watch. If we go to Safari, you'll see on Apple's website, we have Future Forward, where they have a new watch band, Black Unity Braided Solo Loop, and then they push a new watch face. They just pushed this. We didn't know it was there, so they could just turn on Apple Digital ID this way. They also, if you go to find out more, release some new wallpaper for your iPad, Mac, and iPhone. So if you want to read about this is to celebrate Black History Month. If you want to read about this, you can see that, get the new watch band, the new watch face as well, and check it out for yourself. So that's something they've updated today. Without telling us, they just pushed that and pushed a press release with all that information. So they could do the exact same thing with Apple Digital ID now. Now, in previous iOS updates, if you had child communication safety enabled, that's something you have to enable as a parent for your child. If they see maybe a picture that could have something explicit in it, it will warn them that they may not want to click on that or take a look at it. Previously, it said this content could be sensitive to view. Are you sure? Apple has changed the wording to say this content could be sensitive to view. Are you sure you want to view it? So a pretty small update, but they're trying to clarify that for those using it. They've also clarified some wording within Private Relay. So if we go into Settings and then we go to our name and then iCloud, within Private Relay, if you try to turn the feature on and your cellular carrier doesn't support it, it will give you a message that now says Private Relay is either not supported by your cellular plan or has been turned off in cellular settings. Before, it would just say it doesn't support it. So now it's giving you a little more information as to how to enable that. Also, Legacy Contacts has some wording updates. Legacy Contact, which can also be found under iCloud and then Password and Security, this is a way to add someone if maybe you pass away and you need to have them get access to your device more easily. It now says Legacy Contacts can access and download the data stored in your account after your death. When a friend or family member adds you as a legacy contact, their name will appear here. So they've just updated that as well. If you've recently had your battery replaced or maybe your display replaced by Apple, there's a new service section that will show up in the About section, and they've made some changes there. So if you go to Settings and then General, then About, and you've had your battery or display replaced, you'll have a new section available that looks like this. It will say Parts and Service History. They've updated the URL in the bottom here to link to this page to help you better understand what's going on with that. So it's just something they've added and again, completely changed as far as wording and better helping you to understand that. Also, there's one small change they've made that was found in the code by my friend Steve Mosier a little while ago. On the iPad, it looks like there's some information regarding updating your Apple Pencil's firmware. Now, we haven't seen this. If you go into your iPad and go to Apple Pencil, there's not a whole lot you can do there right now. But in the future, it looks like maybe we can update the firmware there, or it might be a diagnostic tool for those Apple geniuses in the Apple Store. So right now we can't do anything with it, but there's code there related to that. So maybe we'll see some new features or changes in the future with that. iOS 15.3 has quite a few security updates in it. If we go to Apple's security update website, you'll see here they list all of the new updates. And if we go to iOS 15.3 and iPadOS 15.3, you'll see that they've updated 10 different things. From Color Sync, Crash Reporter, iCloud, IO Mobile Frame Buffer, Kernel, Model IO, WebKit, and you'll see there's three WebKit. That relates to Safari. It's sort of what handles everything going on in Safari, and that is a major bug where they could actually track what you're doing if the website was using IndexedDB and had this sort of tracker or bug installed. So this patches all of that information, and you'll see here under Impact, that's how you read this, it tells you the devices, and then Impact, processing a maliciously crafted mail message may lead to running arbitrary JavaScript. To fix this, a validation issue was addressed with improved input sanitization. Again, if we go down, processing maliciously crafted web content may prevent content security policy from being enforced. To fix it, a logic issue was addressed with improved state management. So again, that information is here, as well as someone that kind of tipped them off to something they need to patch. So you can see that here, and I'll link that in the description. Now, performance overall seems to be quite good. Like I've mentioned, ProMotion is nice and fast. I've mentioned this quite a few times before. Seems like it's nice and fast. It ramps up quickly to those higher frame rates. On older devices, whether that be an iPhone 10, an iPhone 11, iPhone 6S, if we go to maybe Minecraft here, I loaded that. We'll see how quickly it resumes in real time. Give it just a moment. Frame rates seem to be decent. So there we go. We're already in and we can walk around, and frame rates seem to be decent overall when I used this before and again after resuming. The same thing is true on older devices. So if you have an older 6S, 6S Plus, SE, seems to be nice and fast as you go into things like music. You'll see it's a little bit choppy there. It may take some time to load, but in general, it seems to be okay with loading and everything else. Now, one thing I wanted to note is that it does get quite a bit warm as you're installing this update. I noticed that not only on this phone, but on the other phones here. So while it was installing, the entire back of my phone was warm. Don't be alarmed. It's normal. Apple will manage that heat overall, but that happens when it's using the processor intensively and pulling a lot of current from the battery. So it will get a little bit warm. It's nice and cool to the touch now, but initially it was quite warm. Now, as far as battery life, let's go ahead and take a look at that. Under Settings, we'll go to Battery and then Battery Health, and I'm at 100% battery health. If we take a look at the last 10 days, I've been running 15.3 full time, but if we go back to yesterday with the release candidate, I had 3 hours and 56 minutes of screen on time, 13 hours and 18 minutes of screen off time. That may be related to the music bug. So we could still have that music bug. It's possible it's still here. Apple has not mentioned whether or not they patch that or not. And if you're not familiar with that bug is when you're using music and streaming music, sometimes it can cause an issue where it uses additional CPU power and then in turn drains the battery more. So that's something that they hopefully have patched, but they haven't mentioned, and they may have left for a future update. So we don't really know about that just yet. As far as the storage bug, if we go to Settings, we go to General, then iPhone storage. Under iPhone storage, it seems to load a little bit slow, but it does load. So those of you that were having issues having this load, it seems like it's okay. And it is reporting accurately for me. And I know that it's not for everyone in all of their apps or anything else. But if we go all the way down, it's already even loaded system data and iOS. So it seems to be working okay for me. You'll see it just filled in the icons there. But some people are still having this take a very long time to load, but at least the numbers are accurate. I'm not sure if that's for everyone yet, as the majority of people have not reported back, but it looks like it's better than it was. I'm not sure that it's 100% fixed. As far as the pink display issue that was present on the iPhones, I haven't seen that again, but again, Apple has not specifically stated that they've fixed it, but they did acknowledge it's a thing that they can fix through software. So that happens when maybe the phone locks up and reboots and then shows a pink or purple display. That seems to have gone away. So I think it's okay right now, but I haven't seen any issues with that in a while. But again, Apple has not said that they've patched it yet. Now, as far as if you should install iOS 15.3, I would say absolutely. If you're on any version of iOS 15 or maybe even 14, I would say at this point, patching these security vulnerabilities is a must, and I would highly recommend it. Typically, you're going to experience good performance. I haven't seen any problems on older devices either, or people mentioning that, and the vulnerabilities are serious enough that I would highly recommend it if you can. Otherwise, it seems like it's a pretty stable update, and in the previous follow-up videos I did, most people said it's the most solid version of iOS 15, although time will tell. Now, as far as iOS 15.4 and when to expect that, well, based off what we had last year, we could expect it as soon as next week. Now, sometimes they'll push it out the next day, but based off year over year, it looks like next week might be more likely, with maybe the 1st of February or the 2nd, sometime around Tuesday or Wednesday. But again, Apple changes things up from year to year, so we don't know this 100% unless they tell somebody. So at this point, it could be Thursday or Friday, but it's more likely next week at some point, where we'll see 15.4, maybe some new features, additional bug fixes, and we'll get into beta 1, maybe through beta 4. We don't really know, but I think they're keeping a lot of new features for iOS 16. So I'm looking forward to that, but at this point, we don't really know as far as what they're going to do with 15 anymore. And so that's everything in iOS 15.3, just bug fixes and security updates and some wording changes. But if you found anything else, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. Of course, I'll do a follow-up video and have all the information of how it's going for you since they pushed out a new build as well. Look for that on the weekend. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper though, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.